We're live in 20 seconds.
We're on TV.
Yes, we are.
Oh my God, Billy and I are fighting again.
Yes,
big time.
Now, are we on video, bottom or top? Because top, there's nothing. There's a big blank screen there. Sort of like
they don't care.
Sort of like Marco, blank.
Oh, but Marco's not here.
I know he's
today.
Not here. That's why I said it.
Oh.
Ah, there we go, yeah, Gary. Gary, nice.
Now, everybody,
yes,
hear me out. I get here early. It's not my show.
Paul Revere.
No, Paul Revere.
No, Paul Revere, hear me out. I mean,
yeah,
I
hear
think
me
he's going
right?
to go into a speech.
Paul Revere was a revolutionary. He warned us about the British, but that's not what we're talking about.
No.
Now, I get here at 7:20.
Very good.
I'm talking to the new people.
Yep.
I'm talking to Gino.
Yep.
And the rest of the people, right? Calm. Gino's mom is here. Nice to see her. The people, right? 7:20. Where's Billy?
Not here.
No,
not here.
He admits it.
Not
he
here.
He admits it. All right. So, 7:30.
Not here.
So, Gary Aubin says he's not here. Tyler's alludes, well, we should set up. And Gino and I say, it's Billy's show.
Yeah.
I don't know if we should. So we calmly set up because Billy's not here. We call him. We were going to make fun of him.
Yeah.
Because Billy's not here.
I was pumping gas probably at the time.
Whatever. I don't know what you're
I was. Thinking.
I'm like Judge Judy.
Gas.
I don't believe anything you're saying right now.
That's true.
Liar, liar, pants on fire.
No, it's all
like
true.
Paul Revere was making the midnight ride.
Yeah.
So the round table people, there are two tables that most people at Comcast use. The old desk.
Or the David Bauer round table.
The David Bauer round table.
Yeah, which
no,
I don't
the round
like.
Table is there. Nobody wants to move it because it's really a big thing. It's like a wagon wheel. You got to roll it,
But you know what? It has no wheels and you have to actually lift it. That's
right.
What they don't
want. No,
like.
We don't want to do it.
No.
So we set up the mics. All of a sudden, I look to my left and there I see Mrs. Wilson. So that logically tells me that Billy is probably here.
Yes.
But not necessarily because you never know what's happening. He's laughing. He loves it. He loves it. He's laughing. I wish I could tell you the story about yesterday, ZBA, but I can't. But,
no.
So then Billy comes in, everyone's working.
JG and LS, that's right. All I'll say.
Anyway, so Billy comes in. Billy, we're on the air.
We're on the air, okay.
So, Billy comes in, Tyler's working, Gino's working, the two new fellows are working.
Yes.
And Billy goes, I'm not gonna, he was like a pirate. He was like, girl eyes. I'm not gonna use that, move it.
I moved it. I moved
Gary Aubin. Did Billy did Billy participate in moving
yes,
the table? I want to find
out.
Show the Zapruder film.
did you and I not move the table?
We moved the table.
Yes,
was he involved?
Yes, he was.
But did you do more work?
Probably.
but wait, here's the thing. I had to walk backwards though, so I'm not good at walking backwards with the table.
Billy's
so,
good
yes.
at this. Billy's good at this. And then he's demanding. Poor Tyler. He's trying to do his work. Billy's demanding a Wi-Fi pack. I want the Wi-Fi pack.
Yeah, and it didn't work anyway.
I'm trying to train a new person here.
I know. Poor
but
Tyler.
Here's the problem. Wi-Fi doesn't work. So if we want this to go out over the air for everybody else to see out there in computer land, it isn't happening because
no.
Comcast only makes, so many billions of dollars every quarter, and yet we have Wi-Fi that doesn't work.
Tell them about the TV. Tell them about the TV.
Then we got a TV that you had to smack it three or four times, then it sort of came on, and then it decided to come on again. But here's a kicker. There's a TV on top of this.
Yeah.
And that one is not working at all.
We are the biggest, probably, media conglomerate in the world.
Oh, they are.
World. And we have two bubble TVs.
One outside of China.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
I know. This is Comcast Studios, but with Frontier Services.
Exactly. Oh, it went back on.
We
have TVs from 1982.
Yes.
Men at Work was the number one band.
Yes, they were. Men at Work.
Yeah. Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
Yeah, Frankie Goes
to
Hollywood.
Right. So we just, enough is enough, Comcast. Take your $256 billion.
And give us
buy two TVs.
You can do flat screens. You can do small. We don't care if you do small.
You can go to Best Buy.
Seriously, these TVs are as old as Gino is young.
What does that mean?
Well, Gino's like, he's a
These
young
TVs kid. Are older than Methuselah.
They are.
Yeah.
Yes, they are right. Methuselah. Methuselism.
I mean, I'm sorry.
Almost as bad as some people we have down City Hall.
Oh!
And with that.
Oh my, that was horrible.
Don't introduce us with that.
Hey, yeah.
Hey, exposition.
Hey, it's funny you say that. I love the Democrats, right? The Democrats, they say, we want fresh new faces.
Yes.
Who? Who? Who are these fresh new faces?
Everybody running for council except Dan except for Blanchard is a retread. Let's be honest here. And they kicked off the one woman they had on here.
Right.
To make sure she didn't get on.
She'll be back on.
But she'll more than likely be back on.
She's not the only woman they had on there. They have Mary.
Who?
Well, no, they have Mary, but they threw off one.
He's saying she's
to throw on another male. Wait. I mean, they always call us the party of the white old man. But you know, if you look at their ticket and look at ours, yeah, diversity is not something that they lack a lot of on their ticket, unless you're talking of certain areas.
I mean, Jerry Daly, nice guy, but he's been there a long time. Tom's been there a long time.
22 years.
I mean, 22 years.
It's a long time.
I mean,
older than Gino is. Longer than Gino is old.
But they say they want
Still,
fresh.
I'm not getting these references, but okay.
Fresh new faces.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now we have fresh new faces.
We do.
We have fresh new faces.
We have younglings.
We have Lindsay Frelix, number one for office. Right. She's running
She's
for
fresh.
Common Council.
Fresh
John Pulino, who's never run for Common Council, is running for Common Council. We have, of course,
fresh.
We have these lovely ladies to our right. Yeah. Linda, who was Common Council for one term, coming back again. Take the fight back to him. Deb, who's been a three-time incumbent, coming back also.
We
sad.
Have a phone call.
And David Bauer and Nick
Vizzino.
We have a phone call.
So we have a phone call. Yes. So I guess we'll take the phone call. Then we'll go through everything else. Yeah, yeah. Can we take it? Yes,
yeah,
we can.
Take it.
Okay.
Seth?
Oh, hit the wrong one. That's all right. There we go.
Caller, hello. Please call back. Are you on the air?
Yes, hello.
Hi, caller.
Hello. Hi. This is Leah
Tomaszewski. Hi, Leah.
We will clap tight for all our callers.
Well, thank you. Lord. I just wanted to say how nice it is to see so many women on the GOP.
Yeah. We like women.
Being here with you, Linda and Deb. And we have many other nice ladies, very capable and qualified. So I think we should be very proud of our slate.
Absolutely. We are.
Mm-hmm. And the men we have, too. But, but as you were saying, the Democrats talk a good deal about, you know, women, you know, how they're going to promote them, but we actually do it,
right?
Which I think is fabulous.
I agree. I mean, I think you could talk the talk, but do you walk the walk, as they say? And
sure,
you know, they don't walk the walk always.
Right.
They never do. Seriously, they never do.
Right. And the other thing of note is, I love how we have a mother-daughter team on the slate.
We do.
Yes, we do.
We have Linda and her daughter, Molly.
Right.
I know they're running for different things, but
and
I mean,
granddaughter,
that's very unique.
Our son, to be.
All good. And then we can't forget.
There's three generations.
Andrew, our top person.
Right.
Yep.
So, all good.
Yes, it is. I agree. And again, it's getting a variety of different people from different spectrums. We have young people, in college, people who are been out of college for 40 years, but we have everything in between.
Yeah.
And the thing is that's something you want to see on your ticket. You don't want to see the same old people there. And we don't have that. We have a good variety of people. And hopefully Middletown will make a decision to elect a new fresh face.
This is a four-year term, people.
Yes.
Right.
4 year.
And, I mean, I don't mean to diminish our men candidates, yourselves.
No diminishing.
I'm just saying that, you know, it's nice that we do have many women on the ticket as well.
Yeah.
Right. And I think even in the past, we've had tickets that are very, very diverse.
Yep.
And I've been around the scene for about 13, 14 years, and I've noticed that Billy made a comment about, oh, the Republicans are supposed to be the all-white male party. Well, you know what? I don't see it in Middletown.
No.
We are extremely diverse.
Yep.
We chase after young people. We want to make sure we have people even with different viewpoints of our own because we need different solutions for big problems.
Right.
Yes.
And if you don't, you know, you don't have to agree with everything we say.
No.
But the Democrats say that, oh, no, we're flexible. No, you're not.
No.
I can list off the top of my head 25 people you've kicked off in the last, three cycles?
Yeah.
Sure.
Right.
We don't do that.
No.
We're more inclusive.
Yes, we are.
Right.
You're also nicer to people who help you, too.
Well,
you guys have been very accepting of me, and I want to say thank you for that.
See?
That's nice, Gino.
That's very nice. So that's the thing.
I don't need to tell the Anthony Moran story, do I?
No.
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 No, but I appreciate the call, Leah. Thank you so much. And thank your mom. And you guys take care and have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.
Bye,
thanks, Leah.
That's a very nice phone call. We're accepting calls tonight at 860-613-3031. 860-613-3031. Police calls on live TV. You have Debbie Kleckowski. She's an elected official, and she does answer questions. Yes. You know, you may not like the answer, but Debbie will answer your questions. Debbie will go to your house. You have to ask her to leave. I have. Yeah, right, exactly. Linda's here. Linda's,
that's the wrong elected
right.
official.
Linda will not come to your house.
That's no, Linda will come to your house, but she will leave very quickly. Linda's very good about that.
Yeah, Linda will drop off her jam and her whatever she's cooking up next.
And she made new jam just for
you
people
did?
Out there? Yes, she did.
We made pickles today.
Ooh.
Linda is a bottler. We know. Yeah, we have a call. We know. We have another call.
That's all right.
A bottler,
we're getting a second.
She's a bottler? Wait, that sounds like she could be...
Well, they aren't ready yet.
What kind of pickles?
Bread and butter.
Oh. Let's take this phone call.
Uh-oh.
All right.
Better than name these pickles.
Hello. Welcome to the Variety Hour.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Hey. How are you?
Mr. Giuliano.
I was listening to the discussion about the diversity of our ticket and how many women we have. I think the funny thing is, for us, it just turns out that way.
Yes.
Look for good people, and it just shakes out that a good number of them happen to be women.
That's right.
As opposed to the Democrats, I think they tend to say, we need to put a woman here.
Yes. Right.
Good, bad, or indifferent, you know, they pigeonhole people.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We don't do that. I mean, our ticket is led by a woman.
Yep.
We have three on the council slate.
Yep.
Our treasurer candidate's a woman. We have women running, Molly running on the P&Z slate.
Yep.
We've got women running for the Board of Ed, women running for the Board of Assessment Appeals. I don't think there's any...
And a woman running for P&Z alternate.
It doesn't have female representation on it.
Yeah.
Right. And I know, Councilman, that you've been listening, but I think we've always had those type of tickets. I don't think this is anything new for us. Since I've been around.
No, it isn't. But, I mean, the Democrats put their token candidates up and they beat a drum. Beat the drum and wave the flag over that. We just do it and don't make a big deal of it.
No.
Because, you know what, it's for us, it's not special. It's just something you're supposed to do.
I was just going to say, you know.
You're supposed to put the best people up.
You're supposed to put the best people up, and if you just do it and move on with your business. But those people are like, look who we did. Look.
Yeah.
But they don't tell you about the people they've tossed off because... You know, one of their candidates once had children and things like that.
Yeah.
And I'm not kidding when I say this.
No.
But I don't want to, you know, sit there and muckrake a little bit. But that's all true. But so forth. Right?
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, it is definitely something that, you know, we pride ourselves in, and I think Middletown has done a good job with the Republicans, is we pride ourselves in having good diversity. I remember when a certain young lady first came before us, Molly Salafia came before us. And she came and she interviewed with us 4 years ago, and she goes, "I voted for President Obama. Is that okay?" And I said, "Yeah." I said,
"Wait a minute."
But this is
no, I know.
But I said, "This is local." I said, "This is local." I said, "This is about local
issues,
local stuff." I said, "We're not, you know, this is not national. This is not even state so much, but this is local Middletown stuff." And Molly has grown quite a bit over the last 4 years, and it just shows that, you know, she has a good mind. She speaks her own mind, but she has her own opinions. And again, we don't force anybody to have their own opinions.
Every single person in that headquarters who's on the ballot or on the ticket, I should say, has different opinions about different issues. And they should.
Right.
And they should. And not to be different, but we're human beings have different opinions.
And we're not lockstep.
If you do that.
What's that? I'm sorry, Councilman?
If you do that, if you express a wide variety of opinions, you know, in a caucus or at a meeting.
Right.
And you believe in your position on this, and another council person believes quite differently. Well, you know what? You've got to stand by your position. And if you can't carry the day, then you can't carry the day.
Right,
right.
And
the Democrats, I think, are pretty much told this is the way it's going to be.
Right. And we've seen that with Councilwoman Casper. You know, she had different opinions about pension boards and so forth, and they gave her walking papers.
Yep.
What's even more important, she was right on the matter.
But the other thing is that if you don't allow that free exchange, That approach to take to the council floor hasn't been tested.
Mm. Yeah.
And it's not going to stand up. However, they have the votes.
Right.
Right.
So they'll make an absolutely ridiculous argument for their position, but it'll pass because they have the votes.
And that happened this past week.
Well,
it happened twice.
Yeah, twice.
But I'm being nice. I'm only going for the first thing that they talked about because we have six fields that are going to be put on a thing, but nobody knows what fields they are.
Mysterious fields.
The mysterious fields.
Field of dreams.
No, it's gotten totally ridiculous.
Well,
they've thrown everything but the kitchen sink into this pond.
Right.
And there is no way they can honor the commitments that they're making to all the constituencies out there.
Well, five of you.
This is a joke.
Right. Five of you know that. One a Democrat. Right. But, Councilman, is it true that right now you're ripping up your front lawn and putting artificial turf down?
Yeah, actually, I'm just going to pave it and paint it green.
Paint it green.
Right.
Well, that's good. I that's taking initiative.
I'm tired of mowing it, frankly.
Well, safer than rubber crumb.
But, what I like about, the Middletown Republicans is that, they're, basically erasing that stereotype of all Republicans, how, they're so stuffed shirts conservatives and only one opinion matters
and stuffed shirt
on women and all that. I like how, Middletown is breaking that stereotype.
Yeah, but we have never been part of the mold, in my opinion. But I will tell you this, I expect a lot of people, again, to be at the council meeting on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of stuff going on this coming Tuesday on the council meeting. It's a regular meeting. I just think that people have to be out there, voice their opinions, and we want to hear from the citizens of Middletown. But at the same time, I want to know what's going on with these six extra fields. And I want to know how they're going to pay for every single
thing. And where are they going to be?
And where are they going to be? That's what I mean.
They don't know.
I mean, when you get an answer, we're not sure. I mean, that doesn't give me a lot of hope for how money's getting spent, the $33.5 million or whatever.
But what's interesting? I'm sorry, Linda. No one even mentioned the cost, right, Seb? Everyone's talking about the issues at hand, but it's interesting that nobody mentions $33 million.
The Milone and McBroom proposal. Mm-hmm. That had gone through two council workshops and a number of... Park and Public Works Commission meetings. Mm-hmm. Everybody pretty much understood what was in that package.
Right.
Now, that's gone by the boards. You've got this bigger laundry list of facilities. Nobody has any idea how this is all going to break down.
Because they're making it up as they go along.
Well, because this
they're
is...
They're flying by the seat of their pants. And, the repeal resolution that's on Tuesday night, actually, it's Councilman Sarah that brought that forward.
Right.
And, you can't say we're totally partisan because we're pretty much behind his play here.
Right. Right, because...
But this is in... Oh, wait. Linda wants to say something. Go ahead, Linda.
I just want to say that what concerns me about this, too, is besides Malone and McBroom report, which is mostly the fields, the playing fields and stuff, every council meeting or time that they're talking about the bonding, they're talking about changes to Veterans Park. And I can't find or anywhere that those have really been brought forward. I don't know what they are, they're talking about. And I went back the last couple of nights and read all of the Park and Rec Commission reports that were on the web back to 2011, and then the Public Works Commission and Facilities Commission reports. I don't see any discussion about what's going on at Vets Park, and they're talking about fixing the pool, dog park, all these other things. Where are those numbers coming from, and how are those playing into the 34?
Linda's absolutely right on that. But this was going on one road for the better for upwards of a year, and all of a sudden, within a week, that's all gone, and a whole bunch of things that nobody had a chance to talk about or consider are being thrown in. This is ridiculous, and to go out, it's another election year ploy. Somebody that wants to go out and sell something.
Well, and the thing kills me, and I have to be really honest. I talked to the Trees of Honor, the president and the vice president, at the not the last meeting, but the meeting before, out in the audience, and the president was there the weekend before at the reflecting pool that they have for the Trees of Honor. They're still collecting money for that. They still need more donations. And there was a woman there walking her dog. The dog went into the reflecting pool, and the dog would not leave the reflecting pool. And when she asked the woman, could you please take your dog out of there, the woman refused to do it.
Really?
And again, how is that not going to get worse if you put a dog park there by where we have the trees of honor for those who have fallen in Afghanistan and Iran, Iraq war? And this is just something that can't be done. And the veterans, here's my thing, and I will say this to anybody who's out there, it's a veteran that's watching. You need to stand up to this administration, and you need to tell them no to the dog park being in a veterans park. That World War II Memorial Park was given to the city for the veterans, not to be given for some dog park that some people down on City Hall want to have a dog park. There's other places to put a dog park. That is not the place to put it. I am so
tired of it. I hope they do.
And a dog park isn't just grass.
No, right. It is not just grass. So, it is, and it, there's a liability that goes along with it. There's a cost maintenance.
If people are worried about contamination from artificial turf fields,
yes.
Where do you see the contamination controls you got to put in a dog park?
Oh my!
Well, and that's the one thing, that was one of the issues they had at one of the dog parks up in West Hartford, where they had an outbreak of parva. I think that's what it's called. Yes. It's a dog disease, and they had an outbreak of it where dogs were getting sick, and some of them, a couple dogs died. I said, you know, and that's liability. Who took the liability for that? Well, that was a privately funded park, so the city didn't take any liability. But I guarantee this is not going to be privately funded. This is going to be a city maintained,
right.
And means that we're going to take responsibility if something happens or we have some kind of outbreak. So this is something that can't happen, at least not there. Again, honor our veterans. Let's get sick and tired of, you know, this playing political football.
Right up the road here from the studio.
The other thing is we need to prioritize.
Right. Yes.
Okay, it's not that dog parks aren't a necessity, but is it a priority? Clearly making the pool ADA compliant is a priority. But no one has sat down and said, what are the priorities of all these projects? And they threw in huge projects, but what's the priority? So are we going to build a bike path for $4 million first? Or are we going to build, you know, the elusive six fields for, I mean, where are we? And we have no cost analysis. It's a train wreck waiting to happen. And who's in charge of what? The mayor can't appoint people now. And if he were, God forbid, to become mayor again, what makes me think that we're going to have building committees when he can't even put people on committees? Or if it were to pass, if he tried to do that first. So there is no planning. Absolutely no planning.
Here's my whole thing is that why didn't they take this whole plan to begin with? And why did he break it up into thirds?
Absolutely.
And that way you have a set limit. We're going to come out, we're going to do these fields first, we're going to take care of, this is the highest priority. Pat Kidney's one of them. Whatever fields after that, they're the high priority fields. And then just move down the list. And then you see you go back out for money and get these plans.
And what about maintenance?
I don't know that I would even go in thirds. I would go project by project.
That's
right. We talked about that too, project by project.
If you say Pat Kidney is your top priority, then you come up with a plan for Pat Kidney.
Right.
This is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to do it. This is how much it's going to cost.
Simplify it.
And how much it's going to cost to maintain.
The money that you're given can only be used on Pat Kidney.
Right.
How do you know in this scenario that you have now that what you think you're going to have for Pat Kidney is actually going to be spent on Pat Kidney, or maybe Pat Kidney will get more than we thought.
Right.
And then the things down at the end of the list get shortchanged.
Right.
This is
sort of, or they don't get done at all. That's what's going to happen.
You've had 22
That's what's
years.
Going to happen. I can tell you what's going to happen. The projects that are backed by the people with the most political clout are going to get done first. And they're going to get done well, and they're going to get all the bells and whistles.
Yep.
And the ones that are put there for people that don't have much political clout are going to be at the end of the list, and they're going to probably not even get done at all.
Linda.
Okay.
That's reality.
Linda.
We've had a Democratic council for the last 22, 25 years. Jerry Daly and Tom Sarah and whatever have said during the meetings, we've been here for 22 years.
Fresh faces.
This is how the state of these parks and these fields got to be the way they are, because they have not been done. They've ignored them.
But somehow Republicans get blamed, but there are no Republicans in the majority, ever.
Right. So, and also, the other thing is that in my opinion, and I know it's a cliche, but we're a reactionary council.
Yeah.
Yes.
We react to whoever is loudest and knocking on our door.
Of course.
Closest to an election.
Gee.
So we need to...
How'd you get that opinion?
It came to me. It was like, wow.
It was a reaction to the current events.
Really? Yeah. So you're saying you bring 25 people in to complain about one thing?
You bring in 42 people who speak out against something. So everything has changed in a matter of a night. And then it doesn't get done. And then they have to come back before, because then the mayor all of a sudden decides, well, we have a primary coming up in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
We got to make this right. And we have to do it by the following day, because we have to have everything done to have it on the ballot for the following day. So we can't do anything else.
She say, by the 8th she has to have it done?
18th.
By 18th. Yeah. But it had to be done absolutely that night.
They were at zero hour.
I think it wasn't people just acquiescing to that. I think it's because people were getting a handle on things.
Right.
If the projects were big, nobody, I think, recognized that this was coming forward. I think they thought it was a report that was going to be done either piecemeal or have some plan of action. This voting for money and then getting a plan is just not efficacious at all. And this is why we get jammed up. Let's not forget a $15 million mistake for Matt Abassett.
Which I spoke about 2 weeks ago.
Yes, you did.
My issue was, and it still is to this day, that, again, here we have a $15 million mistake, and nobody is going to pay for that mistake.
Except the taxpayers always pay for the mistake. Yep.
Right, and we always pay. And, again, this administration, I might hear it from somebody later on, but I don't care. This administration has never taken responsibility for their goof-ups. They never pass the buck. They just say, oh, well, they raise their hands up and say, well, this is what happens sometimes. And, you know, nobody has to pay for
this. They're stoic and they're creepy and they keep making bad decisions. Seriously.
And we're stuck with the bad decisions.
Mm-hmm.
More taxpayers. Well,
we have to clean up.
Yes. We have to clean up.
That's the important part.
May
I mention something about Tuesday?
Make some changes. That's all I've got to say. You got your opportunity in November to change it.
Yeah.
And, if you don't, you're going to be stuck with the same scenario for the next 4 years.
That's
right. So vote Roe B.
Roe B.
November 3rd, vote Roe B. Thank you, caller, and have a great time.
I wanted to, Jonathan, I don't know if you received the letter, but I received an email today.
Yes.
Very interesting that due to the hot weather there for the Middletown Public Schools, there will be a half day on Tuesday.
I got a phone call. They don't like you.
No. But I did get the email. Which is fine. I get it. We have state maximums. I think what's happening in the schools that don't have air conditioning, they don't have a chance to cool down.
Right.
So the heat is reaching that state maximum. I get that. But if you read the letter, the last sentence, because of global warming.
Oh, I didn't see that.
So I think it's curious that.
Really? They actually had that in the literature.
Yes.
Prior to the letter.
Your email.
Why is that a shock?
It's a decision that's a hard call, and I never want to disparage any superintendent for making a call on school or no school, because there is no winning. You know, it's flurries, they cancel.
It's hard.
Then they don't cancel, and it's a major storm, and buses are stuck. In this case, we have a lot of vulnerable students with asthma.
Sure.
I don't think the schools are cooling down, and that's becoming a big issue because there isn't AC. But I just thought it was interesting that a controversial political statement was the last sentence.
Yeah, I didn't see. I heard.
And they are going to look at school again, and it's not uncommon for September to be hotter than August.
Yeah,
Indian summers and October.
Right, and the big thing is, I've always thought we should have done in schools, and this is something that was a very simple thing. It's just have exhaust fans sucking out the hot air. In certain areas,
I think we should have that at council.
Well, we probably have the council. There's a lot of hot air in the council chambers. That's for sure.
Billy.
But
I can tell you, I can honestly tell you that, you know, when I was in school, and this is like I graduated in 2013, it was unbearably hot during the summer days,
mm-hmm.
And you know, it was like the heat distracts from the education, which in turn provides horrible test scores. So we got to cool down the classrooms.
Yeah,
well,
but I
won't even get into the SBAC test because that's a whole other issue.
Well, may I say something about the SBAC test?
Yes.
I did talk to two board members.
Yep.
As we know, Middletown did not fare well. 23% of the students passed.
On English, and then how many on math was less?
Yes.
In general.
So I said, I'd like to see my kids' test scores.
Right.
And I was subsequently told, not yet confirmed by two board members, well, we don't believe that parents are going to get the individual test scores.
You pay for them.
So I don't know where that is, but I put that out there to parents. And the administration, you know, Board of Education, not necessarily the administration, but the Board of Education, mm-hmm. if you are giving our children tests, mm-hmm. state-sanctioned or not, whatever mm-hmm. the case may be, we can argue Common Core mm-hmm. and opting out. Mm-hmm. I want those test results, period.
Oh, God.
Well, and how can I help my child?
Right, and that's your tax dollars. You're paying for that
But
test.
I can tell you, I did that. I asked. They were, well, they wanted quantitative reasoning or different things.
Maybe you should get 46 people and go down to the Board of Education
meetings. The superintendent had to step in because I asked for samples of whatever the students were learning, and they said, we can't provide that. And the superintendent, that's not her job.
What did Linda say before? She said, maybe you need to be really loud, really obnoxious, and go down there with 46, 57 people or whatever.
People are afraid. I can't even get people.
Afraid of what?
We have eight. This was my other point. I'm sorry, but now riled up about
this. Why would they be afraid?
We have Tuesday off. We have the next Monday off.
What do they mean, afraid of what?
A half day.
They can't tell you your kid can't come to school.
No, but the retribution and parents are afraid.
Retribution?
I have to say something.
Parents are afraid.
You can't. There's nobody there.
Okay. Listen, this is what I want to say real quickly. I don't know. Okay. Here's what I want to say. There it is. There's the camera.
Nice.
Okay. Nice. Here's what I want to say. If you're a parent, you have children in the schools, do not be afraid of what the Board of Education and what the administration can do. They should be afraid of you and what you can do. Your voice speaks loud. You pay their salaries.
Go down there and complain.
You need to step down there and go out there and let them know this is what we want.
71% of the town's money they control. We should have more people going to the Board of Education meetings, the town council meetings, to be quite honest with you. They're the ones with the purse strings. Did I say springs?
I know we got textbooks in the schools older than me, all filled up with graffiti and stuff.
You should be able to go and sit in your child's class.
Yes.
For the day, anytime.
Why can't you do that? We don't have an issue with that.
I'm assuming you're supposed to be able to.
Who said you can't do that? I
think that schools would want you to play. I don't know,
not
but I'm assuming.
We tell kids in PPTs, and the mom will say, look, if you're not doing well, I'm going to show up unannounced.
And that has
good
happened.
For you.
Yep.
I want you to do that.
When I was
care.
In the schools, there were parents that sat in that classroom.
That makes a difference.
But I will say, can I say something?
Yeah.
I will say there was a former Board of Education member who was a member of the GOP, mm-hmm. very proactive guy, very proactive person. Started showing up at the schools just to see what they're doing. Not at the banquets, not at the, you know, the dog mm-hmm. and pony shows. Mm-hmm. And he did receive a call from the Board of Education chairperson, mm-hmm. who I think was Teddy Roska at the time, and says, they really don't want you to show up during the day to see what goes on the day-to-day operations.
Why not?
So this person,
expose.
Well, the Republican Board of Education member, ignored him and continued to do what he wanted to do. But you're right. There's some type of control there. It's bizarre.
It is bizarre, but I just bring that up because we have 18 half days every other Monday.
Right.
So now we have a half day on Tuesday. Look, that's a tough call. It's supposed to be
90. Teachers don't want that. I'll tell you right now. I don't care what you hear.
I
don't
care if
you're hurt. No, they're going to tell you the party line because retribution. You just said retribution.
No, I mean,
of course they're going to say that.
And I have heard that Board of Education members have said to me, well, teachers really believe they need more.
Board of Education members have to say that because the teachers work for them.
And I have to pay extra. I have to pay my child to go to Kids Corner from 1:15 to 3:30, even though I'm paying taxes, because twice a month,
I heard Kids Corner pays you to take the kids away, I heard.
I wish.
Thank you.
So I'm just, you know, these are some really big issues.
Right.
I tried to get parents involved, and I said I will be there gladly spearheading. And again, these tough issues, and parents are also busy. They're mm-hmm. they're intimidated to speak in front.
Well, that might be true.
But you can send letters.
What are retribution for if you go to advocate for your child? What are they going to do?
There are stories, and we all know people with stories.
No, I understand. Being afraid, personal fear is one thing, but retribution is a whole different story.
Well, I've talked to parents, and representing parents in the class situation.
No, I know, but I don't know. I just can't. How do you get back at a parent for coming in?
They get back at the child.
You're back at the child, which is...
Oh, I am a victim of that, I'll tell
you. Oh, boy. So, calm down there,
boy.
Gino. Calm down there, Gino.
High school. Oh, yeah.
It's okay. Just settle down.
Settle down there, young man.
But it would be great for all people to get involved. You know, we have people saying, people don't know who you are. That's because people are busy living their lives.
Mm-hmm. Right.
People do know who we are when they need something, whether
it's
a road or
a
tree.
That's a whole different issue. That's a whole different
issue.
So
they do know how to look up their representatives. And the other issue is, you know, when I was on the other side of the aisle, I was a very high vote getter, first or second or something. And then I changed parties and I plummeted. So it's not just about who they know. It is about a Dina R mentality, which is very unfortunate. But and that's I'm a good example of that. Not the only example.
But the real story of you leaving planning and zoning was because you were thinking your own thoughts.
Yes.
They weren't happy with that.
We
had these conversations at Maloney in the hallway.
Yes.
And you jumped to the other side, and you became a councilwoman. And I don't think they were too happy about that.
I don't think so
either.
Because
you can say the words they said to you. I've repeated them anyway many times on the show for comedic fodder, but it's all true. They said some nasty things to you.
Yeah.
Well, and let's even say here. They said sexist things to John.
Well, John and I had the same situation.
Yeah, where he got elected to the office, and his wife was pregnant.
Yes.
And he was basically told by somebody who works at City Hall now in the legal department that he shouldn't be there because...
But a D.
I don't know. It's a D. Legal department. I'll say her name. Nancy Raska.
Say it.
I mean,
who cares?
Again, she said he shouldn't be there. You were told by your own party, who were the D's at the time, well, you have children. You got a call. Maybe you shouldn't
be
there.
Asking me to leave.
Well, that is outrageous.
Yes.
That's outrageous.
But that's election. I mean, I think that is... shifting an election and not going by the electorate.
Yeah.
And there was nothing illegal. I did call about that.
Well,
it's
outrageous. Because if it happens to us, it's like a shrug. But if it happens to them, it's on the front page of the Middletown Press, and God forbid, this and that.
And as you can tell, the Middletown Press always cover these things so well and unbiased.
Good job, Middletown, Victoria. Good job.
No, it's not even here. I mean, it just is the paper. I will say this, and
uh-oh.
You know what?
Uh-oh.
And I'll get in trouble, but I don't care.
You're in trouble.
Middletown Press, you know what? You've done two stories on the Democrats' Board of Ed. Do a story on us. I know you say you're going to do one, and then you have to do another one on them.
Right.
Again, 3-1.
Equal time.
Sort of reminds me of how things are in Middletown. We have 3-1 Republicans and Democrats and Republicans. Now we're going to do 3-1 stories.
Very interesting.
To my opinion is that, Cassandra, you know what? You want to show something to people in Middletown. You want to show that you're unbiased. Start doing stories on both sides, not just this unbiased
side.
Run them side by side so people can make their own decisions.
Instead of whitewashing.
Well, even the blog the other day, they had, I think, Gina Sarah and I think you, right?
Yes.
They had two candidates, a D and an R.
Right, which I've got to actually change that because my bio was wrong. It was pointed out by Brian Caskell, who said that you're not running for Board of Ed. So now it's an old one. I haven't changed my bio.
Oops.
And the picture's old, too. So.
Wait, that picture looked good. What are you talking about?
No. This looks good now.
That picture looks
better. I look like Puffy the Dragon in that one.
The Magic Dragon?
Yeah.
But the point is, even the dumb blog, who they can do anything they want, had one of each.
Yes, right? Yes.
So the point is, the Middletown Press needs to get it going here.
And they used to be an excellent paper. They had some excellent investigative
reporters. I'm not running against the press, but you know what? They're not doing anything anyway, so how's it going to hurt me? They don't cover both sides.
I don't think they go in depth either. Some of these issues.
No.
Channel 8 had something on turf versus grass again. A lot of things coming out. I was telling Linda, I met a superintendent today of a school system not far from here, and he was talking about it and concussions and not having turf on a football field. And if you talk to ADs and coaches, some of the concussion is because we're better at diagnosing concussion,
right.
And all coaches have to go through a special concussion. So this is an issue not without merit.
Well, also the helmets are better. They have these new helmets.
No doubt. Right. But I'm just saying that this is an issue that does have merit on both sides, wherever you are on the side of the issue. So it should be investigated. That's what the press is for.
But here's a kicker about all that, and I'm going to throw this out there. They brought up Brantford and Cheshire, the two towns that built all these nice new grass fields. What they forgot to mention, these lovely people down there, I'm not going to get their vote, so I don't care what they think of me.
Oh, my God.
They failed to mention that Cheshire and Brantford both have multiple turf fields.
Multiple.
So let's not make this sound
this person isn't from Cheshire or Brantford.
Yeah. Cheshire, and again,
investigative reporting that should have come out.
Of course it doesn't come out, and that should have been brought out there. It's just like, okay, they put all brand new grass fields. That's great. But I said they did that because they've already had the all turf fields, what they have for certain sports like lacrosse, soccer, and football. So for the younger kids, I will say this to anybody. The younger kids should be playing on grass fields, period. Play on grass fields, let them have fun with that. But if you're into more advanced sports and you want to do league stuff and you want to do varsity
stuff.
But
we should get paid by tournaments to come use our fields.
Well, Middletown High has a turf field, and yet.
And they do get paid. I understand they do make income off of that.
So it's a turf field, and here's my question is that if everybody's worried about, maybe we should tear down those fields, because I noticed that Pat spoke.
Yeah.
Geez, Pat, are you going to tear down your field? I'm just curious, because, you know, you're going to put in all grass in there?
Well, also, I heard...
I think they're really looking at the elementary schools with open space.
Well, but that's different,
you
that's
know,
fine.
The open fields and the ball fields. And somebody did mention, I don't know if this is true, Linda, I don't know if you know this, but do turf fields have to be gated? Somebody mentioned that.
Well, it's not like a pool where you can't drown in them.
That came up. I didn't know if it was true.
I don't know. Maybe they do. I don't know.
I don't know.
Hey, Councilman, I can tell you this. And I hope this isn't true, because we talked about the dog park. Mm-hmm. We talked about some other things, wasted money. I heard.
Uh-oh.
Listen up. I heard that they're actually going to put artificial turf on the new bowling alley.
What bowling alley?
I'm joking. I'm going to lay out the
board here. Wait.
Indicative of something they do, though.
Hey, we have a bowling alley, but it's just underground. And it's just not been used for the Kirks. Remember the Kirk family?
No.
The Kirk family used to own a bowling alley.
You mean next to Sweet Williams in that area?
That was the 36 lanes
underneath.
Oh, yeah. You didn't know this was underneath WOW.
Underneath WOW?
Yeah, WOW. Middletown Lanes. That was the Kirk family. The Kirk family owned it.
Yeah, but that wasn't a neighborhood.
But Kirk family owned it.
Sue Kirk, we went to school with.
Her family owned it, and the rent got too expensive. They had to close down.
Well, they put artificial turf.
Washington Street.
Yes. A lot of people from the high school.
I miss those days.
Oh, yes. I remember that.
Bill, you don't even remember those days.
I remember that.
Linda does.
Linda was a responsible mother during that time.
Was not.
Hey, Linda, who'd you like better, Elvis or Buddy Holly?
Ooh, and Linda.
Wait, she's not that old.
I actually bowled there.
See?
With Buddy Holly?
With Elvis or Buddy Holly?
Either one of them.
Whoever
the gentleman was that owned the place and was running the place.
Yep.
Billy's friend.
Had to take me aside and show me actually how to bowl properly.
Like in the Curtis family.
That's good.
That was nice, though. Wait, that was very
that
nice.
That wasn't a secret bowling alley.
But you're not entering.
But it wasn't a secret. Well, it's a secret now. Most people who live in town, they don't know about the bowling alley. I'm going to be in there now.
Me too.
You make it seem like it was a Masonic temple.
I can't think of...
No, that's on South Main Street. That's there for me.
It's not a secret either, though.
No.
It's not the Knights of the Templar. You went underneath.
Yeah.
You had a long hallway.
Yep.
You went underneath. Yep. And it was so cool.
Oh, yeah. I love it.
It was very neat down there.
It's like Boppers in Hartford. Yeah. You know, you go down those stairs.
I would love to go down to one of those, like, secret societies.
Oh, there's one right here.
You may never come out, though. That's a problem.
The secret society, they're called Democrats.
Well, anyways, on that note, we have about 17 minutes. So,
yep. Do we have 7 minutes?
You're watching the Variety Hour. I'm John Pulino. This is Billy Wilson.
860-613-3031.
We will take your phone calls, because unlike the other party that rides with Democrats, we listen to the calls and
we want to hear from you. And the story goes, and Marco could tell the story. He's not here today. He's out in Seattle. So have fun, Marco.
Tell the story anyways.
He said that he was videotaping. He was helping out with the show that was here. It was a Democratic show. It was live. But he said, why don't you take phone calls? He says, and the person who is a prison council person said, we don't need to hear from them. We don't need the public. And
it was
live on tape.
It was live on tape, but it was live. And he said, why didn't you
they don't
do
take
this?
Calls.
And he says, because we don't care what the public. Basically, they said they're stupid. Yeah. And why should we listen to them?
Oh, my. I'm sure that Linda Slavin.
All I have to do is say this. Wait. This will tell you who it is without me saying a word.
I know what
I think.
Watch this. That doesn't mean anything.
Wait, come here.
I'll go better.
Guys. Tough question.
That's better. That's better. Excuse me, Council. Guys, right? Is that better?
But some people who know the inside joke, that's why I did that.
I actually get that. But
I know you do, and I know they do.
Oh,
I'm the one in the dark.
That's better. You want to be
that's right. You're better off in the dark sometimes.
But I dare Democrats have a show and use the phone. Live, by the way, live. Just use the phone, but you know, let people call you, because you're elected. You've been there for 24 years or whatever. You know, you want to put fresh faces.
Since 93.
Yeah. So guess what, guys, gals, whomever, take phone calls. You owe it to the people. I dare you. You can even come on the show and I'll sit with you. I won't talk. Yeah, right. I can't help it.
Yeah, I mean.
And I also just want to let people know real quickly, because I just want to throw this out there just so people know what's going on this month.
Yeah, give some shout-outs. I got a shout-out.
The 11th of September, September 11th at 8 o'clock, Bob has the diner.
Yeah.
I'm not sure who his guest star yet, as of yet.
Me and Linda, I think. Linda and I. Oh, and also on September 11th at 8:30 in the morning, a 9/11 memorial service
down
at
Salafia.
Okay. It's a very nice service, and a lot of people from the community come out.
All right, and also want to let you know, September 15th, I am doing a special show. I'll be doing it twice this month. Once this month, once next month, meet the candidates.
Nice.
We will have on the
young crew.
Diverse candidates who are the young people who are running for office. Meeker.
Fresh and faces.
Yep, fresh and faces. Fresh Molly Salafia. Also.
She's not that fresh, though.
Well, she's sort of
fresh.
She's fresh.
She's been around.
No, but she's fresh. And then Emma. Sven. And Chris Petter.
Right.
So they'll be the four that'll be on, and so you get to meet some new people. John and I will be here, hopefully.
We'll be here, yeah. And Gino's show is what, I think, on Friday at 7?
Friday at 7.
Gino, right.
And he does it twice a month, right, Gino?
No, I actually do mine like Bob, either weekly or bi-weekly.
Okay.
I actually want to have Deb and Linda on.
Well,
all right. So that's something to talk about. So the 15th. And then John's show comes up on the 22nd of September.
Yes.
And that will be at 8 o'clock here live. And
now,
you know who you're...
Yes, I do, sort of.
Okay.
Well, usually during political season, I get a lot of people running for office, but I am absolutely willing to give my hour away to a Democrat that will answer my questions on live TV. If you want to come to the show, we can have ground rules. You know, I'll sign an agreement. I'll do what you want to do. I dare you to come on my show in a non-confrontational way, except for one person, Nancy Conway-Rosco. But... No, I'm serious.
But she's not running for
now.
It doesn't matter.
No, she doesn't have to run for anything.
Don't remind me. I forgot.
She's got a good job up in making big money.
She's making big money, right?
Yeah, somebody who couldn't do the registrar's job, but that's a whole other issue.
The Peter Principle, right. So, listen.
Yes, I know the Peter Principle.
Right.
Yes.
And I know Peter. So, because he picked a peck of... Anyways, if a Democrat wants to come on my show that night and discuss why he or she should be elected, please do. Like I said, you know, it's not a debate.
No.
Take phone calls from the people.
Yeah,
you owe it to them. You owe it.
Because you know what? What the Democrats need to remember, and this is what the Republicans already know. This is what it is, people. This is Gino Cuddy talking. Gino in the evening, by the way.
You're not Mike, though. But talk louder.
Yeah.
This is.
Oh, no.
So the thing that they need to know is that they're not. They work for us. We don't work for them.
Right.
That's true.
That's the thing that the Democrats need to realize, that what the Republicans already know.
Okay.
I mean, look at John and Billy here, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, they're Republicans, and yet they take every screwball call that comes their way.
Especially tonight.
Yeah.
Wait. That was not nice. I liked their two phone calls.
I'm kidding.
He's kidding.
They were decent.
They were better than usual. We were entertaining, too.
We
gave you the information.
Yeah, but we
and
also
pulled back.
We pulled back.
And we're kind of
funny. And their personality. And pulled,
thank you.
You can learn from them.
No, but he's better. He's better. I remember the orange hat, so it's much better. Trust me.
Are you going to mention September 16th is the Democrat primary?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Well,
you're talking about.
I got to mention something here. I will just throw this out there.
I'm throwing it out, right?
Okay, throwing it out there. Uh-oh. Okay. The 16th from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. is the Democratic primary here in the city of Middletown. It's also statewide for other primaries that happen. Also, to let people know, we are having a CNN Republican debate watch over at El Popo. I want to say it correctly. Is that correct?
I think so.
We are having that, and it'll be from 5:38. If you want any more information, go to my Facebook page. You can email me at UCONNONE@sbcglobal.net.
It's at the end of the show.
And maybe Gary will throw it up there one time quick for me. And if you want any more information, but we're going to be doing a viewing party of the Republican debate, and also have some nice little tapas and helping out a local business. The guy's just starting out. We want to help him out. And his name again was?
Cleaver.
And he's a very nice gentleman, and hopefully we can get some people to come there.
First.
Yes.
Good.
Anything else about the election?
We are running.
Well, we're running. Like but besides us running, no. Well, say it.
I understand there's some controversy on who's doing setting the voting booths.
I did not hear this.
Oh, no.
I don't know. You have to tell the viewers.
You have to tell me this. I didn't know.
You knew.
No.
I don't know the entire situation.
I'm excited now.
Okay, but as
I like your quote, by the way. Very Don Johnson, circa 1985.
Thank you.
She doesn't have the 9 o'clock shadow.
I do know Don Johnson, and I do know Miami Vice. I don't know all the circumstances, but as I understand it, there is some concern that the Democrat Registrar of Voters, who is the wife of a running councilman, is setting the machines.
I thought she couldn't do that.
No, I think that has already been done, and this is a big issue. It may not be illegal, but when you're in government
unethical?
And you're representing, you do there. You immoral. Know, just because it's not illegal, there are things that you know can be that are just improper. So, you know, this is something for a discussion. If you have, you know, a spouse or whatever running mm-hmm. for office, should you be anywhere near
but
voting machines?
I hate to say it, but that is the Middletown. Unfortunately, that is the Middletown Democrat way. For example, I'm on the Zoning Board of Appeals. John Pulino and my wife bought a shed. But before we bought the shed, we needed to get, you know, permission from the
right.
ZBA. I'm
right.
on the board. So you know what I did? When my wife came in, I walked out of the room.
Right.
I couldn't hear what she was saying.
You always walk out of the room when you're
right.
wife
but
comes
my point
in.
Is, it's just a tiny shed. I felt, you know,
well,
I have
could,
no business.
No,
being
you could
there.
You could have
right.
went and sat in the audience and just
right.
didn't like
right.
everybody
you
else, and then you could.
But you know, it's
way,
intimidating
so
just being there if right. you are part
but,
of that.
But
right.
my
you
point
did
is
the right
that's
thing.
Such a small thing. But yet this person, they don't care. They do what they want to do.
And no one's accusing anybody of any wrongdoing. I'm just saying
right.
it leaves a bad taste in people's mouth when, you know, it makes a leap.
Yeah.
And, you know,
well,
all
actually,
of us.
I'd like to say something without using any names. This same person, I believe I know who you're referring to, made a comment to me because I also do some work at Channel 19, which is another studio, and said, since you're running for office, you shouldn't be able to run the cameras. And he works there, too. And I'm kind of thinking, that big H word, which rhymes with hypocrisy, I'm kind of going,
well, you know,
whoa.
Wait. All I have to remind people of is this, that David Boyce, when he
yes.
was going to do the cam work down
good
in back,
guy.
He good guy, who couldn't do it because he was working for the city of Middletown at the time, and they didn't want to have to pay two different times. My question is this person who's saying these things works for the city, not elected official, mind you, she's never elected, she is working for the city, and yet she has no problem collecting two paychecks from the city, collecting one for being a register and one for working the cameras. I don't know. I mean, David Boyce had to step down. I don't understand why she's
right,
still there.
But he did it without a problem. He
right,
understood.
Right.
Okay, you know, no
well,
problem.
Well, there's no doubt David Boyce has
he's
class.
Yeah.
Yes, and he has ethics.
But we do need to look at this situation. There's other issues with this,
right.
and we can't, Middletown tends to manage on personality.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yes.
Not
oh, yeah.
on, Linda
React.
Knows.
React.
Okay.
I have a concern about, I think, because I think her husband, they need to get an iron for the shirt. I was very upset about that the other night. I didn't really care about the turf or the grass, but the shirt, he was
the scruff look?
Maybe not the scruff look, but it was very wrinkly.
It was wrinkly?
Oh, I didn't notice.
I'm in the corner saying, you know what? She's worried about the voting machines and so forth. They have the shirt. Go down to Kohl's or something. Get the coupon.
Get the old steamer out.
So, but you're absolutely
make
correct.
The sign of the cross because some people need that more often.
I mean,
than
my
others.
Husband's come before planning and zoning, or his partner
but,
came before planning
but you
and zoning.
But slept in the shed for a couple nights.
Yeah.
No, she
and
was
I
up
left.
In the apartment up above.
Well,
upstairs.
She liked that to get away from the boys.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, you got to recuse yourself for something like that. If you know someone personally involved, you should just recuse yourself and just that's
it's
it.
It's not right. It's not fair to the other person.
No, it isn't.
It has nothing necessarily to do with
but
the person.
She's putting her spouse in actually a bad position.
Yes.
That's what you're saying?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Maybe she did that a long time ago. But
no, that would never happen.
Get
no.
the dogs off.
Not that time. Let the dogs out.
Okay, boom. We have 4 minutes.
You want to give
no,
a statement, Linda?
Yeah.
No, we have about 6 minutes.
I know.
You can argue with me about 2 minutes.
Well, no, because we have about 6 minutes.
I think you need to tell them what you're running for.
Oh,
you
yeah.
You didn't even do that.
No, because I feel, this is a segue.
Yeah.
What I was going to say to Councilman Giuliano when he was on the phone, and I'm going to say to you two, I have never been on a ticket. I've been on about 5 of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this ticket is interesting. I don't see a lot of egos.
No.
Well, I like that. Like,
I like that, too.
Like, I like the fact that everyone has an ego, especially Deborah Kleckowski.
Yes, tell
it's,
me about
it's
it.
Bigger than a small country. But I'm kidding.
I know she doesn't like meatloaf.
Okay, but no.
Right.
But the point is, I've noticed
not the guy, the group,
when I go,
but the food.
When I go to the meetings, when I go to the caucus or the Republican meeting or the strategies or egos really aren't there,
no.
which is a good thing. It
no.
shows that people care about Middletown. Which is why I didn't want to let you know what I was running for.
I didn't think. I think that people.
We're doing this.
I think people know. I think people know.
We're working together. We're working together.
Do it again. Do it again.
Together.
All right, I'm running for common council.
Yes.
I currently hold the office of Board of Assessment Appeals. I also sit on the Zoning Board of Appeals. I'm also the chairperson of. Now on my ego, right? I'm doing a resume. Okay.
Okay.
I'm also the chairperson of the Cable Advisory Board.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, when I'm elected to something, or appointed to something, it sounds corny. But I really think that I'm supposed to do a real, real, real good job because people put me there.
Yes.
I have to do a good job.
Because you represent who?
Right. The folks.
There you go.
No, and I don't even want to say constituents. I like to say people.
People.
People. Because I think if people are going to vote for me, first I have to iron my shirt. Right. Yep. But I have to show up for the meetings. And I do show up for the meetings. Which I know Marco Iacovellio, who's not here tonight, he's on cable advisory.
Yep.
He had a big issue with the woman we were just talking about not showing up. Because she never showed up.
Nope.
She went ballistic.
Yep.
But she, show up.
Show up.
Show up. The point is, do your best. You know, research the topics. You don't have to agree with everybody every time. I fight with him all the time. On cable board, on tonight. But guess what? We work it out. I walk home, and that's how it works.
And John DeFilia, the Laurel and Hardy of the Republican.
No, we're not.
No,
we're not.
No. I have better hair than Laurel.
So, anyways, I'm running for common council. I really hope that you would vote for me. I plan to go door to door, so maybe I'll see you at your door.
All right, we got 5 minutes. I'm just gonna do my quick thing real quick, and then we're gonna do the two ladies real quick.
Well,
so what we'll do is that just real quickly. I'm running for planning and zoning. I was a member of planning and zoning from 2001 to 2005. I am the vice chair of the Cable Advisory Board until they throw me off.
Oh.
I am also the vice chair of the Republican Party. I am on the Harbor Improvement Board. I've been on a number of commissions.
A hat for that?
Yeah, I have a hat. It turns sideways
Skipper
and stuff.
Hat,
yeah. I should have worn my hat tonight. It said Grand Poobah, which I got from Molly for my birthday in Little Sis. But that's what I'm running for, planning and zoning. Hopefully you'll vote for me. And but more than anything, I want you to vote for the team. And we are row B, and I want you to vote for all of us. These ladies here to the side who did a wonderful job. Linda was great on the Common Council. Deb's been doing a great job. We want these people to get elected again. We want back some common sense in Middletown, and we need a lot of it.
Debbie lives the Common Council. It's ridiculous. They kick her out of the chambers. Go.
Or the Chamber of Horrors. Yeah. I want to yield my time to Linda.
No.
Wow. Look at
go, this. Linda. You're next.
Well, I spoke about the Board of Ed, and
I'm running for the Board of Ed.
Yep.
This time, and I'm also running for council.
Wow.
Yes.
And I, too, I'm excited about our team that we have running. We have a lot of good people this time. Not that we didn't in the past, but a lot of people who have a lot of experience in different things and different are coming at this from different angles, and it's exciting to have a lot of young people. Mm.
And that is a big thing.
The whole team, I don't think there's a weak link among them.
No, I agree with you. And agree. And you know what? Here's the thing I love most is that we get along. But we get along. Here's the thing that comes down to. We may argue behind closed doors, but then, you know what, we straighten it out, and then that's okay. But then we straighten it out, and then we come out unified. And that's how it should be.
You have to argue because it would make, we're not robots or drones.
No, not
like
somebody else.
We don't always come out unified in the sense we don't have to vote the same way all the time. We come out with the expression of our point of view.
Yep.
And people may be a little bit ticked off initially, but it's respected and you move on for the greater good.
Yep,
that's
the
difference between the Republican Party and the Democrat Party.
I agree.
That is unified in their votes, you know, despite what their personal feelings may be. So I think it's important that we respect each other's point of view and then we move on for the greater good and work as a team and as a unit, trying to get things done.
Yep. I agree with that 100%. We've got about 2 minutes left.
And ladies and gentlemen, I just wanted to, you know, put in my last 2 cents here. And, you know, I'm just an ordinary citizen like you. And, you know, I host my own show and everything, but I'm still just an ordinary guy just trying to make it in this here world. And I can tell you by looking at John Pulino, Billy Wilson, Linda Salafia, Deb, and Sandra, and Seb, you know, I have full faith in these people can make a difference and make this town livable again. You know, take it back and make it what it once was. Make it good.
And we're going to give that
Republican, Democrat.
And we're going to give that PSA out to Gino Cuddy. Gino's a good young man, and my nephew, Charles Cole, thought he was a really good guy, always liked him, and said that he was very happy that he was helping us out. And so that's a good thing. So Happy Labor Day.
Be safe.
Happy Labor Day. Be safe. And
all right,
remember,
Gina, come back here and wave with us.
Wave. Come on out here, Gina, and wave.
Now you can come out.
He puts the hat.
Might as well wave.
All right. Hey, folks. See you next next week. The ladies will. Gino's show is coming on next week. We'll take care. Have a great week. And be safe this holiday weekend. And don't drink and drive.
Or text.
Or text.